In the late 70s, young British blacks found a musical and ideological ally in the punks.
What we were writing about was everyday life, and what the reggae musicians were writing about was everyday contemporary life, what's happening now, the violence, the poverty, the injustices.
Out of the punky reggae explosion came Rock Against Racism, which was really a response to the rise of the right wing that was happening in the late 70s during the kind of time of social crisis, you know.
Rock Against Racism brought together reggae and punk bands in musical protest and solidarity.
Up to that time, black bands didn't play on the same stage with white bands. That's a really important point to make. People forget that now. You had black concerts and white concerts. We got increasingly large stages to perform in front of, where the audience was saying, we never instigated this segregation between the musicians, and we support this coming together.
The Clash offered reggae performers a new audience, but this was reggae in punk clothing.
We weren't trying to do a slavish copy, we were trying to give our interpretation of ingredients to our music, you know. And, you know, people say, oh, it's not like reggae. It wasn't meant to be like reggae. It was our... We were a punk group, you know.
The Clash embraced the work of respected Jamaican artists and producers like Lee Scratch Perry.
The thing is, Police and Thieves was quite a popular tune at that time. We decided to do a cover of it, which is quite interesting because Lee Perry said, when we finally met him, he said, oh, what do you think of our version? He said, oh, you ruined it, which made me laugh.
The punk movement had in common with the reggae movement was that it was frowned upon. People, you know, looked at it as an inferior genre. So together, you know, they came out fighting, you know, and then everybody wanted to be some reggae in his punk tune.
Dennis Bovell was asked to produce the debut album of the punk band The Slits.
It's very normal for me to feel that music was a conduit for protest, and that's what punk was, and that's what reggae was as well, and I think that's where the two really came together. Was it's about talking about life on the streets when you were an underdog, where you had no money, you had no voice, and you wanted to point out the wrongs in the world, and your only way through that was through music. I think what reggae really taught punk musicians was about space and letting, you know, being brave enough to let there be holes and gaps and dub even more than that, because punk was very strict, very fast, you know, get through it as fast as possible, very, very urban, whereas reggae was also came from an urban background, but it was about letting go, being loose, and it was such a relief after the strictness and the minimalism of punk. This is a street way of getting your voice out there, and, you know, punk and reggae both did that.
Reggae was now finding its way into even the most unexpected corners of the country. Hidden away in a leafy London suburb was a musical foundry that would feed British sound systems throughout the land.
Well, right now, I'm going to cut two wicked dubbing and get for the jar, you know.
Yeah, I'll let the boy tonight, you know.
Yeah, Mr. Cox's not the best sound, man. We rule, you know.
Whilst thumbing through the Yellow Pages one time, looking for a place to cut an acetate, found Hassle Recordings, phoned up, gone over there, an elderly gentleman who was famed for smoking a big fat cigar. John Hassell answers the door. And we go into his house, into his living room, right? And he's got this wonderful German disc-cutting lathe set up in his front room.
They had come to cut an acetate, the metal dub plate from which vinyl records would be cut.
And his wife, Felicity, has offered us like a cup of tea, a cup of coffee, and you know. And then we put on these tapes and it's like reggae. You know, imagine stumbling on that through the Yellow Pages, right? And then we were telling other people, listen, we found a guy who, you know, who knows how to cut reggae.
We're cutting straight down, aren't we?
You can have a fantastic sounding thing on the tape and then it all fall to pieces at the cutting end of it. And someone who would be sympathetic to the frequencies and know how to capture that sound from the tape onto the disc. And John was a master at that.
It's an esoteric world. It's a world of subtlety and refinements. To them, sound is important. It has a meaning. So it has to be done right and professionally and proper.
Next stop for Bovell's British dub cuts were the sound systems, where DJs would preview new tunes and gauge whether the dancers liked them. But sound systems only wanted to preview Jamaican imports. To get British reggae played required a further sleight of hand.
So we had this idea to get a machine that could make a big wide hole in records that were pressed in this country. And don't put on it made in England, right? That would be another dead giveaway. So just, you know, and put as little information as possible and then parade them as pre-release and mix them in with the Jamaican stuff. And very often they passed off as that. That was definitely the way of getting our music played on sound systems.
To decide which pre-releases would become hits, sound systems used the old Jamaican tradition of bare-knuckle competition.
It's like, you know, Mike Tyson gonna fight Lennox Lewis. People pay to see and people wanna go because they wanna see what they don't know what the outcome's gonna be, but they go because, you know, and the sound system clashes, it's the same kind of thing. You know, they wanna see who's gonna play the best music on the night.
The most powerful and respected sounds were Jashaka, Coxon, and Saxon. Each sound had its own partisan following and its own DJs.
We were always looking to Jamaica, but when Saxon came along, you know what I mean, Jamaica started to look to us, which was never done before.
There was a new confidence and a sense of homegrown identity to the British sounds coming out of the black communities in areas like Brixton. Perhaps British reggae's most distinctive voice in the late 70s was Linton Kwesi Johnson, who pioneered a distinctively British dub poetry.
Ganja, crawling, creeping to the brain. Coat like hurting, breaking, hurting. Fire in the head and a dread beat bleeding, beating fire.
Dread is dread, dread is fear. Dread is a kind of terror. Dread beaten blood is kind of this, it's a kind of a metaphor for the tension and the violence that were a part of that culture of resistance to which reggae was so central.
His record, Dread Beaten Blood, absolutely knocked us for six. It was his delivery, his words were so clever, the beats, it was so understated. It was like nothing you'd ever heard before, and he was like a god to us.
I don't begin with a piece of music, I begin with the word. And the language of the verse I write will determine the rhythm of the music. I hear music in language, so that in a poem like, for example, Hit No Funny, I say them with tech chants, and that's what exactly what the bass plays. Da 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 da. And the horn section will play the same rhythm as well. You know, that was my aesthetic, that I wanted to write verse that sounded like a bass line. I wanted to write lines of poetry that sounded like a reggae bass line.
The mix of instrumental sounds, the bass and echo effects in Dread, Beat and Blood were the result of an unusual partnership.
The great thing about dub is that it's the engineer's art. It's what the sound engineer does. It's the deconstruction of a piece of music and its reconstruction as an act of illusion. By act of illusion, I mean you have a spatial dimension which is created with echoes and reverbs.
British dub is quite a lot different to its Jamaican counterpart. Quite a lot of young British people like the fact that the echoes will take them into a different world, you know, or you could hear your favorite song mashed up. You know, it was like making scrambled egg.
Wovell's first experience of this musical bricolage didn't come from Jamaica, but from an album he had at home.
I'd thought that the first dub I'd heard was Jimi Hendrix's song called Third Stone from the Sun. The amount of echo on the guitars and the sound effects in there were positively the first sort of dubbing I heard, right? And then to find that creeping into reggae, it was like, yeah.
It was this mixture of early influences from pop records, school friends and sound systems that would earn him the title Godfather of British Dub. Dub sounds became part of the musical mix for many British rock and punk bands at that time.
Now, Police came along and turned reggae into rock and roll by adopting the Jimi Hendrix experience style of a three-piece band, drums, bass and guitar, and playing reggae.
We completely bastardized reggae. We plundered it without remorse. We took from it what was useful to us, but we made no attempt to repackage it and deliver it back unto the people, which would have been false.
The Police began life as a punk reggae band in 1977 with an agenda all their own. Roxanne, off their first album, became their signature tune.
The first time I heard Roxanne, I heard Sting coming up with this song. And he had it as a sort of a bossa nova with the chords going. So it was a very soft and kind of sexy song. So, well, yeah, really nice. But bossa nova, this is the punk scene. You're going to get killed. We started to sort of change it around. And we were sort of being influenced by reggae at that point, and to see if there was some way we could change the drumming.
And so we reggaefied this bossa nova tune that he had written, and it's not even real reggae. You know, Andy Summers, his guitar part, is not the up chick, it's the downbeat. He plays one, two, three, four, chick, 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 chick.
And that locked the whole thing together. So we had the straight four on the bar guitar, and the drums doing this kind of reggae feel, and the bass line going with that. So it's like doom doom da, da, doom doom doom.
Try to be as mercenary as possible because we want to conquer the world, but actually we can't resist playing with this thing that really is fascinating us and turns us on, and we find this new rhythmic formula, and which applies to Sting's newfound ability to write fancy chords with a guitarist who can play them, and it was like candy for us.
At the same time, there was a little group of mainly Midland bands digging further back into Jamaican history. In Coventry, they were reinventing the sound of the 60s. Two-tone were a kind of musical commune that included Selecta, The Beat and Madness. They injected old-school Jamaican ska with a new punk energy.
You know, the two-tone guys, they were from Coventry, and Jerry Dammers, this, you know, the maestro who pulled that all together, which was the weirdest thing. I mean, I never got to know Jerry at all. Some of the other guys, yeah, but Jerry seemed like a complete mastermind. I don't know how, what part of his brain was working, but some part clearly was in focus.
I'd say we were the beginning of the imitation generation, you know, we were, at least we were one of the first to do it. We were like the Jam. This was like imitating the past, but in real life.
This was our inspiration.
It'd be really hard to say why retro culture happened, but it did, and it was exciting.
I think it was good from the point of view that it probably introduced a younger generation into that music. And you go and find the originals, and it's like, ah, oh, that's what it's about, you know. And then those originals lead you on to something else. It's like, you know, they're like stepping stones, I think. So I think two-tone was important from that point of view, you know.
The ska that we played was very different. We didn't really know how to play Jamaican ska properly. If you listen to it, it's actually a strange fusion of bits of skinhead style, a bit of mod style, a bit of Jamaican rude boy style, you know, mixing it and matching it and creating something which never actually happened in the first place, exactly.
I believe, periods of huge energy and change. And I think youth always needs something to kick against. And if the political climate feels more oppressive to them, they will kick harder and something else, something bigger and better will grow out of it.
In a way, the Specials is playing out a kind of the drama of British society on the stage. You know, that was part of the concept.
Two-tone. I think that we were using elements of that time, of what Jamaican reggae artists and Jamaican ska artists like Lauren Aitken, Prince Buster, all those kind of people, and the Scatolites were doing. But we were really of the punk generation.
Kind of recycle, okay?
A 3 Minute Hero was about what it was like to have a job clocking on and just living in a way just for the weekend. Hey, yes. possible for us to use political lyrics with that kind of music and still keep it high energy.
Pauline's band, The Selector, added the strongest punk stamp to this 60s retro culture. They toured the country alongside The Specials with high energy songs like On My Radio.
On My Radio showcased the vocals because of the very high On My Radio, that kind of business going on. It sort of sounded a bit like Kate Bush crossed with, I don't know, you know, Millie Small crossed with some other kind of reggae thing that was going on. It had all the ingredients of a quirky pop song, and people loved it.
With the two-tone at the time, the ska revival, I always found that there was a closer connection with punk than there was with ska. It was like a lot of what would normally be a punk band would get up there and play an offbeat, and suddenly you've got something that sounds vaguely like ska.
None of us was really interested in being part of what was effectively just a ska revival. To start playing ska was like taking two steps backwards, you know what I mean? So we wanted something a little bit more long-lasting.
The band that would take 70s reggae into the pop charts for the next 30 years was a bunch of Birmingham lads.
We called ourselves a jazz dub reggae band when we started. But we wanted to make reggae music, you know, that was important to us. It wasn't going to be Jamaican reggae, you know, because we were a British band and we wanted to make British reggae, like a hybrid. Environments totally shaped who we were. I think if you went to Halsall Heath, which is where most of us grew up, and grabbed eight guys off the street, they'd look pretty much like us. They'd be the same kind of racial mix. We were immediately more attractive, I think, to a British audience because we were mixed.
And as far as our image goes, we had no image. I mean, like, image, you know, we just wear what we wore anyway, you know what I mean? We went into dressing up in uniforms and suits and whatever, you know what I mean? Yeah, what you see is what you get.
We were called UB40 because we were all signing on at the time. A friend of ours suggested the name when we were trying to think of a name. And he said, you've all got UB40 cards. Why don't you call yourself UB40? So...
But it was honest as well, because we really did, you know, come from that, you know, without being able to take doll money, we'd never have been able to afford to rehearse for a start. We'd have had to get a job. You know, so we were actually in the middle of that. So it wasn't something that we took from the outside just hoping that we might attract an audience. You know, it was something we were responding to the circumstances we were in.
So obviously when we made our first album, it was just a natural progression to call it Signing Off. Because we weren't signing on anymore. You know, it was a facsimile of the UB40 card.
It was pretty clever because it gave us, you know, 3 million card-carrying fans instantly. It sold 8 million copies, you know, and for an album Made in a Bedsuit, that was pretty good going.
To us, reggae didn't represent palm trees and beaches, you know, it represented the inner city. You know, that's when I heard reggae music, that's the image that I picture in my own head.
By the dawn of the 80s, new wave reggae from Two Tone to UB40 was taking on Thatcher's Britain.
We were touring the country. You know, Margaret Thatcher was busy closing down huge swathes of British industry because they weren't profitable. She was like Al Capone, I would guess, because her mob weren't getting paid. She was going to shut them all down. So that's what happened. And we were touring the country, and we could literally see it happening.
This star is coming like a ghost star.
Ghost Town just captured what was happening all over England at the same time. It was all closing down, all your local corner shops were closing down. Dance hall was getting closed down. It meant something to you. People getting angry. We went with the Ghost Town. I got a good solo in Ghost Town. And I think I did everything in that solo. I was talking about suffering, I was talking about goodness. If you listen to that solo, you'd hear everything that you'd like to hear in the music. I play my trombone to speak for all those who cannot speak, and because I have the opportunity to be there. We know oppression very well. We know oppression very well.